I'm Marilyn Priel with The Better Part. Did you know that there are more than 30,000 species of seashells? Our guest will tell us about some of them and about how he has dived the ocean depths to collect many of the 5,000 shells he has in his personal collection.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
My guest, Alan Blue, retired from United States Naval Aviation after 30 years of military service. He has spent every year since that time diving and adding to his seashell collection, begun while in the military. It now totals more than 5,000 and includes 1,000 different species. Alan, you've collected so many. How did you collect all those?
Well, I started out scuba diving and finding shells, and I thought they were so beautiful and so many different kinds and colors and so forth. I kept wanting more and more, and I wanted more different kinds, different species, and I continued and still do it today.
When did you do your first dive?
In 1968, I took a scuba class in Hawaii and went on my first open ocean dive there and continued throughout the 10 years I was stationed over there.
How many dives have you done?
I've probably done 1,000 dives.
Where are the places that you've searched?
Most of it was in Hawaii, and I still go back and look for shells in Hawaii. But being in the Navy, I was able to travel all over to all over the Pacific, the Indian Ocean, somewhat, Philippines, Japan, Okinawa, the islands, Midway, Kwajalein, Guam, American Samoa, just so many different places.
Sounds like you've had a lot of fun. Where are the best places?
Hawaii's good. Philippines probably has more shells than anywhere else in the world. Hawaii has a lot of endemic shells only found in Hawaii, and some of the shells there are bigger and prettier than shells, same shells found in other places. So it's a great place to collect.
Now, I presume that shells are, even though sand is sand and water is water, are they all indigenous to certain places in the world? It's like mammals and other animals.
They are. Some places isolated, like Hawaii, has shells found nowhere else, and other some shells make it across large distances of the ocean and are found a lot of places.
Do they actually travel then?
They travel in the currents. They're carried on floating items, and also ships carry shells from place to place in their ballast. They use pump water in for ballast, and then they'll dump it and move shells that way.
That's interesting. I know that you also do a lot of spear fishing and so forth. So
you mentioned spear fishing. Yes, I started diving at night in order to spear fish. It was you can get up closer to them at night, and also finding some shells at night you don't usually find in the daytime.
Are some easy to find, certain species easier to find than others?
They are. Some of the very common ones you can find. You can find them reef walking at low tide. Some, the ones that are rare, of course, are very hard to find, and takes a lot of looking.
Are there any of them dangerous, poisonous, or anything?
They are. Some of the cones, well, all the cones are poisonous to a certain degree, but some of them can be dangerous to people, can be deadly even. Here's some found in Hawaii. All are very dangerous, could be deadly. There's even this one, 1 inch long.
Whoops.
you
used to have one.
I got stung by one of those one time.
Oh, you did?
It was like a bee sting and was burning for about an hour, and then I was
but
okay.
You said stung. They don't have stingers like a bee, do they?
They have a little arrow they shoot.
An arrow?
Yeah. These have arrows that they shoot. They eat a lot of little calories. They shoot the thing and he dies right away. And they go and they eat him out, eat the inside out of it. This one has an arrow with a little string attached because it shoots fish. Shoots a little fish and...
Like a harpoon.
A little, yeah, right.
It's bring it back.
So the fish can't get away and he dies very soon after. This shell will come out of this, the animal come out of the shell, engulf the fish and digest it until he's able to pull back in the shell. Takes a period of time. This is the first shell I found when I first made my first scuba dive. This is a leopard cone. It's a fairly large one, and I'm very proud of that, my first shell.
Would you put shells in your bag and fish, or do you have separate bags?
Except for the very small shells I put in a small container, I put in with the fish and octopus or whatever I catch, lobster and
they don't fight, do they?
No.
Do the shells and the fish fight?
They pretty well. When you disturb a shell, he usually pulls back inside. The animal pulls back inside the shell and for protection.
Mm-hmm. You know, you talk about them pulling back inside and everything. It's difficult for me to imagine that creatures live in all these things. Would you tell us about the little animals that live in shells?
Yes. The gastropods, which are the one-piece shells, have a little animal like a snail, has eyes and has tentacles. And he comes out of his shell and he has a foot, which is like a little slab of meat, and he crawls on that on the bottom.
One little foot, huh?
1 foot, mm-hmm. And he slides along on that. And if you disturb him, of course, he's pulls back in for protection. A lot of them have an operculum, which I don't have one to show you, that will cover the hole after they pull back inside.
And oh, like a little membrane or a little muscle?
A little hard,
something?
Crusty shell or slab that is attached to the bottom of his foot. Mm-hmm. So when he pulls back in, he closes up the shell with that.
Mm. They adapt, don't they? And they have regular organs. And reproductive organs? They don't lay eggs like fish or anything?
They do lay eggs. They do have reproductive organs. And I've observed them mating in my aquarium. The female lays eggs. Usually they will sit on the eggs, especially the cowries, will sit on a pile of eggs and wait for it to hatch. Before leaving, and then the eggs, after they hatch, they float freely in the current in the plankton until a certain point, and they drop down to the bottom and start growing a shell.
Now, the shells are what interests me, because I know that this fellow here was not born with that shell.
Right.
So how does each shell develop? Just like the stripes on a zebra develop?
No, usually they'll start out without a shell and it drop to the bottom and they'll start creating one. And this one, for instance, this is the very beginning of the shell here on the tip. It's very small and it keeps growing. He has a mantle, what they call a mantle, a layer of skin that they secrete the material that makes a shell, and they keep swirling around, getting bigger as they grow. Eventually they get so big, and then they'll just continue all their life growing.
He's actually manufacturing this,
yes.
A spider makes a web then? Or?
Yes, the mantle produces the calcium carbonate that is the shell. They secrete this and actually attach it, not like your fingernail grows and pushes out. These actually build onto what they already have. They continue growing around. Hmm.
So how big might this one grow?
This is a very large one, the largest I've ever seen. This one also is an albino, I think. It's the only one I've ever seen without the color on it. This is the normal color of them. This one I found in Midway. And this one also, very, very big marlin spike augers there, Treva maculatus.
Tell us about these shells along here.
Okay.
The names and describe them a little bit.
This is a Triton's trumpet. I got this one in the Philippines. The one over here is a Chiregra spider conch. I got it and found it in the Philippines also. This one I found in the Philippines, a very large clam. Giant clam shell, each side weighs 12 pounds. I do have a larger one home, weighs a total of 70 pounds. Over here I have a Rimosa murex, a very pretty shell. Yeah, this is a spiny oyster, and it has a little coxcomb oyster growing out of the top of it. Attached to the top of it. You find that in a lot of shells. It'll have other shells growing on them. This Rimosa murex here, do you want me to?
Yes, and tell us about all these little spikes. It looks to me like it's grown those as camouflage, like coral or something.
Yes, it provides some camouflage, also some protection against certain animals here with the sharp things. And each row of spikes is a finished lip. He'll get out to a certain point and then he'll finish it off with this. Here was the previous place he stopped growing and finished the lip. And prior to that, another one. So they start out very small here and they continue on, and you can see each place he stopped.
One lip at a time. Then.
One lip at a time. Mm. I find a lot of them, like this helmet shell over here. I find a lot of those in Hawaii, and I never find one that's not doesn't have a completed lip. So I suspect they go under the sand, grow the complete the lip, and then come up and fatten up again till they want to go back down and grow some more. Hmm. And I imagine that's the way of a lot of shells. They hide very well while they're growing that until they get that lip finished.
Hmm. So it's almost like a butterfly waiting to come out, and when they come out, when they get their shell all the way they want it, you suppose? Or?
They don't.
All right, I'll let you tell it. What about this one, this prehistoric looking one here?
Okay. About 65 million years ago, when part of the ocean covered Canada, there were a lot of these ammonite shells that grew there. They came. They're found in all different sizes and different colors, and a lot of this, of course, they've turned to stone now, but fairly heavy. But even in Oklahoma, when the ocean covered that, we have some prehistoric shells there. Not as pretty as the ones from Canada, but still prehistoric.
That's a beautiful one right there that you just touched.
That one?
You could make some beautiful jewelry with that.
Yeah, that is pretty. Of course, these have been cut and polished.
Oh, mm-hmm.
This one I think is very interesting. It's this is like a nautilus with the chambers, and each one of the chambers in this fossil is like a geode, or like rocks you cut open. You find the crystals growing inside.
Mm-hmm.
Here we have the crystals growing inside the chambers of this shell, all the way around.
Oh, that's beautiful. Like Apache tears or something that would be in a rock?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Here's another one that's partly cut out of the rock. This still has a very shiny part of the shell.
I realize. Do these shells all come out looking like this when you bring them up?
Not all of them. Some of the shells are very clean and pretty when you first get them. Here's a couple.
Oh, that's the cowrie.
This is a tiger cowrie. Mm-hmm. Tiger cowries are found a lot of places in the Pacific, but only in Hawaii do they get big like this. Most of them are half that size.
And those come shiny and smooth, just
they
like
do,
that.
They do, along this golden cowrie, this came from the Philippines. They have a mantle, that mantle I mentioned before. They bring out up each side of the shell and cover the shell. That provides protection. And with that mantle, they apply the color to the shell and actually grow the shell thicker. Once they've turned over like this and created both lips, they don't get any longer, but they will get thicker. We have a humpback cowrie. Mm-hmm. I find a lot of these in Hawaii. In fact, I find them reef walking at low tide at night.
There's a little hump along
there
the
is.
Top, little bump.
Huh? All of them are rounded on top, but mm-hmm. the humpback cowrie has a little extra bump up on top of the shell here. That's why I call it a humpback.
That's a beautiful color.
This is a map cowrie. They don't find these in Hawaii. But I brought this because it looks like a little road map on top of it.
Oh,
that's because mm-hmm. when its mantle comes up, it's not smoothly, it's not straight on each edge, so it fits together roughly there. Mm. And that ends up being a result.
Such a beautiful color.
Here, you like that? It's an Argus or an eyed cowrie.
Oh, yes. That's gorgeous.
Appears to have eyes on all over it.
Mm-hmm. So they're all... Now, would you see a lot of them like this, or was this one unique shell?
No, this
it's a little family of
these. This
too.
Species,
yeah,
species. All have the eyes like that. All look very similar to that color.
What are they called?
Argus.
Argus. Well, I've seen your huge collection of seashells at your home, and you have them arranged drawer after drawer, on shelf after shelf after shelf. And they're arranged according to species. And you knew the names of almost all of them, and you could remember where you found most of them. It was just, I don't know how you do it. But so what would be your most favorite shell that you ever owned?
Well, I like the cowries. I think they're prettier. They're also easier to clean and mm-hmm. take care of. I guess the probably the tiger cowrie is my favorite. I really
this
enjoy
one,
finding these.
This one particular one or just the species?
No, just the species. Mm-hmm. As far as a particular cowrie or a particular shell, I think this one. It's a Alisoni, found in Hawaii. This particular shell was found in 1919. It was in Dr. Ostergaard's collection back then, and his collection went to a shell dealer in the area here, George Mendenhall, who gave me this shell. And I think that's what I treasure most, although money-wise it's not worth much, you know.
What would be your most valuable?
Most valuable? Here would be one of them. Let's see. I mentioned Dr. Ostergaard. There was a shell named after him called a Cypraea Ostergaardi. That's probably worth $2,000. Very small shell, but very rare. Hmm. Found in Hawaii. This is were live found in Hawaii, which makes it pretty valuable. and Fool Tony is another one. It's very rare. And it's probably worth $2,000 or more. And this shell is found off of Africa in very deep water. In fact, they first could only find them in the stomach of fish. Fish, deep water fish would eat them, and then they would catch the fish and find these in the stomach. More recently, they've been able to catch them in shrimp traps that they put in very deep water. So it's pretty valuable.
there was one that shell that could have been named after you. Would you tell the story about that?
Sure. I found this particular shell in Hawaii back in 1969, I believe it was, and it looked similar to two other shells, but wasn't quite either one of them. One shell, here is, they used to call this Terry's, and it's only worth less than a dollar, maybe 60 cents. This one, Rationiana, I found several of these. That's worth about, it was worth about $60. It's worth more now. It's pretty rare in Hawaii. And this shell looks similar to both of them, but not quite the same. So I didn't do anything about it. I even put it in my aquarium alive and saw the mantle, and that's how you can identify them better, is by the mantle they put up over the shell. And 2 years later, Dr. Allison Kay of the University of Hawaii named it after Dr. Burgess, who is a big shell collector, called it a Burgess eye. And when the publication came out and I saw that, I realized what had happened. So I knew Dr. Burgess vaguely. I went to his house a couple of times. I took my shell. And
you took this shell?
Took this, and he verified that it was a Burgess eye.
But if you had, if he had not jumped in on it, how would you have declared, you know, like they name a planet or so, how would you have established your name on it?
The first one who publishes a description of the shell also provides the name for it. Mm-hmm. And they can name it after themselves, or they can name it for the person mm-hmm. who found the shell, or whatever. Some shells are named because of what they look like. But including in the scientific name of the shell, it has the name of the person who named it, along with the date that it was named.
Well, it's too bad he didn't put your name in there along with his. Like, it could have been a Blue Burgess.
Well,
your name
he named that shell before I even met him, so.
Oh, well.
Too late.
Okay. Well, how do you learn the value of a shell?
The value, if you're going to sell them, you can go by different things. There was a man named Rice, Tom Rice, who used to publish a magazine or item with all the shells and the prices that people have offered them for. And he no longer does that, but now you can find at shell stores. Some books that they put out about shells will list prices. But it's mainly what you can get for them if you're selling them.
Are there very many collectors?
There are. There are a lot of collectors. I know a few in Hawaii, and my son-in-law, Kelly Moore's, sells shells on eBay, and people from all over the world buy shells from him.
Mm-hmm. So it's a lot easier now then, I guess. Just go on and look around for what you want. You were stationed here at Moffett Field during a portion of your military career. What were you doing there?
I was in Hangar 1 in a training squadron. I did a lot of flying in the P-3s. I had a ground job in operations and scheduling. I used to schedule a lot of flights. I spent 4 years there.
And I know that you were a judo champion while you were at Moffett. So tell us a little bit about that.
Okay. The gym was just across the street from Hangar 1, so I went there a lot at lunchtime. And I took up judo. They were training people in there, so I took that up and was active in it for 2 years. And 2 years in a row, I won the Naval District Championship. And the last time I participated, I went to a All Navy West Coast Championship Tournament, and took third place in that in the heavyweight division, which was a lot more than I weighed, so I felt I did well.
Are you doing any of it now?
What's that?
Are you doing any judo now?
No. In that same tournament, a guy about 250 pounds put a hurting on my shoulder and injured my shoulder, and I gave it up after that. I was had it in a sling, had my arm in a sling for a while.
Oh my goodness. Well, you've gone from the heights of the sky to the depths of the sea, and that's been quite a trip from your boyhood origins in rural Oklahoma. Have you ever had any frightening experiences during all these years?
I have. Some in aircraft, but not anything serious. In the water, I've been close to a lot of sharks, which can be scary, especially at night. And I had one serious problem diving. I came up from the dive and had a light stroke before I got in the boat.
How did that happen?
Well, I ran out of air when I was doing my decompression period at 10 feet and came up with no air to breathe, which I should have been letting out air, and I don't know if I did or what, but I got to the surface. I felt so tired I couldn't get in the boat. My son-in-law and my friend Don Hubner, they pulled me into the boat, and they were all shook up, and their radio didn't work, and no signaling devices, but luckily a Coast Guard helicopter came over the boat real low just at that moment, and they waved him down, and he picked me up and took me to safety.
My goodness, that is exciting. Alan, I've really loved hearing about your shells. They're just so beautiful, and thank you for coming and teaching us about them. It's been a real pleasure having you.
Well, thank you, Marilyn. I've enjoyed it.
And we're happy that you joined us. We hope you enjoyed this show as much as we did, and we hope to see you again very soon. Bye-bye for now.
Anu kumuhulae, ku aika.